and the ninth verse. While you turn into it, also Brother Dobbs was supposed to mention the ladies' fellowship tomorrow night week, Monday night week for the group B. That is from the age, I think, 45 and up. So they'll be telling you more about it. If I don't know if he mentioned it or not, but you should be receiving something in the mail this coming week about it. But if you have your Bibles this morning, I'd like for you to turn it to 2 Corinthians, the second chapter, and the ninth verse. Before we read God's word, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, God, we thank and we praise you. That God, we know that you're on the throne and that you hear and answer prayer. And Father, this morning as we gather together, we don't have to ask for your power and your presence here because we've already seen your presence, already felt your power. Father, we thank you that you're already in the midst of our in the service. And Holy Ghost, we thank you that you're here this morning. And Father, we ask you to touch each and every heart from the front of this church to the back of the church. Let every life be touched this morning. And Father, let us realize that this day we must choose the God that we're going to serve. And this day we must decide the God that we're going to follow. And Father, we ask this morning if there's one here that their name is not in the Lamb's Book of Life. Don't let them leave until they've been born again by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And Father, this morning, if there's one here that their hand has slipped back from the old rugged cross, reach down this morning and get them and draw them back into the kingdom of God. And Father, this morning, we ask you to encourage the church and bless your people and to strengthen your people and to let your people know that you're still on the throne and that you still can hear and answer prayer. Father, this morning, as I preach your word, let us live according by your word. Let us hear your word. Talk to the church this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. If you have your Bibles this morning, I'd like for you to turn it to 2 Corinthians, the second chapter and the ninth verse. For to this end also did I write, that I may know the proof of you, whether that you be obedient in all things, to whom you forgive anything, I forgive also, for I have forgiven anything to whom I forgave it. For your sakes forgive I it in person of Christ. The next verse is where I want to preach from this morning, the verse 11. Lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. There's so many devices that the devil is using in the day and hour that we're living in, that we got to be careful that we're not ignorant according to his devices. The Bible tells us in 2 Peter 3 and 5, for this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God the heavens were of old and the earth standing out of the waters, which out of the water in the water. Here was Peter saying that there's some people that are ignorant to the things of God, but they are willingly ignorant of the things of God. There's some people they know not to do wrong, but they still do wrong anyway. We need to be careful, as Paul was saying, that we're not ignorant of the devices of the devil. Where the Bible tells us the devil would sift us as we was wheat. Well, what is wheat? Some of you may you're from down here in the south. There's not much wheat that has grown. But I was in China one year and I watched the way they done the wheat. The way they do wheat is a very unusual way they do wheat. The way they do wheat is they take the wheat and they cut it off and they bring it in. In China, they do it different than they do it here. In China, they would take the wheat and they would beat the wheat. They would take the stalks and they would beat it on the ground. Well, sometimes the devil would sift to beat us around a little bit. But Solomon of old said, be sure to know that if I fall, I'm going to rise again. The Bible didn't promise that we never would have a problem, but the Bible promises that he'd not put more on us than we could bear. The promise in God's word is that I would make a way for you to escape. In China, they would take this wheat and they would beat it on the ground in order to get the seeds to come out. So many times the devil would beat you around and it seemed like he'll put more upon you than you could bear. But church, God's going to make a way for us to escape. There ain't no time to give up and there's no time to quit. There's no time to raise a flag and say, I'm going to surrender, because we're not on the losing side. We're on the winning side. We're not on the defeated side, but we're on the good side. And the Bible tells us the devil would sift us as we would wheat, as if we were wheat. In China, they would take the beet and they would beat the wheat on the ground. And about that time, then they would would have some other people, and they would come around and they would stomp upon the seed. What were they doing? They were separating the good from the bad. They were trying to stomp out all the separate the seed away from the inner seed. So many times the devil will knock us down, hallelujah, and sift us as we was wheat. He'd get upon us and try to tread upon us as we was a doormat. But be sure to know, if we fall, we're going to rise again. The devil may be trying to sift you this morning as wheat. And as I stood there and I watched the farmers in China as they were stomping around on the wheat and separating it, then about that time I seen some others take a hold of the wheat, and they would take the wheat that was on the ground and throw it up in the air, and all of a sudden some things went flying off, but some things come down. What was they doing? They were separating the trash away from the wheat. It had to go through this process in order for the good to come out of it. There's going to come a time in your life it seemed like the devil has beat you down. Going to come a time in your life that it seemed like the devil has walked on you and stomped on you. And about the time that you think that you've been trotted upon, then he's going to take and throw you up in the wind. But be sure to know, if you hang on to the word of God, whenever you fall, you'll fall tried as pure as gold, as tried by fire, you'll come out shining. Whenever the goldsmith, he puts that gold, he puts it in the fire. Why does he put it in the fire? Because he wants the gold to shine. He wants all the imperfects to burn off. I believe before Jesus come, the trying in the church is going to separate the sheep from the goat. I believe in the last days, we're going to see the church go through the fire. But what happens every time the church goes through the fire? There's a separation that takes place. Them that are not in it for the right motives, them that are not in the church because they don't love God and love the church, they fall aside. But them that love God and they love the church and they love the word, they'll stand true and they'll stand fast, unmovable, always abounding in the works of the Lord, so that their labors are not in vain. Church, it's time for us to learn the devices of the devil. It's time for us to learn that the devil cannot destroy us and the devil cannot defeat us. It's time for us to get into the word and realize there's a heaven to gain and there's a hell to shun. What did the devil's got to be stupid in some ways. But just stop and think about it. If I was the devil this morning, I would do some of the same thing that he does. I kind of see some of the weapons that the devil works are very effectively. If the devil can ever get you to get your mind off of the things of God, he's got you destroyed. If the devil can ever get you to occupy your mind with things other than godly things, he can destroy you. If the devil can ever get your mind occupied with the things of this world, hallelujah, how did the devil get Samson? It was not that God didn't call Samson, God called Samson. It wasn't that God didn't, and that Samson didn't hear God, Samson heard God. But Samson occupied his time with the wrong thing. What happens to the church world today? If we're not careful, we are occupying our time with the wrong things. Brother Steve, what are you saying? I'm saying you need to get up in the morning and not say, God, how much money can I make today? God, how much good can I get for myself today? God, what are you going to do for me today? Look at all these things I got to do today. But you get up in the morning and say, God, I want to be a witness of you. I want to let your light shine in me. I want me to glorify you. I don't want to be myself, but I want to show the blood of Jesus Christ. Don't let the devil occupy your time with the cares of this life and you lose the vision and you lose what God has got. Be careful of the devices of the devil. Give Jesus a hand clap. Maybe I can speak a little plainer this morning. Sometimes the devil don't want you to read God's word every day. If the devil can get you not to read his word, he's got you defeated. He's got you destroyed. Some of you get up in that morning time, you don't pray from morning until you start to go to bed at night time. What is it? That's one of the devices of the devil. He gets you so busy with the cares of this life until you forget to fast, you forget to pray, you forget whose side that you're on, and you forget who you're supposed to be representing. There's so many times that people get gets their mind on occupied on the wrong things of life. You say, oh, but we better live. We're only going to live one time. And oh, how true that is. But we better make sure the way that we live down here is going to mean that we're going to live eternally over there. Because some people, all they're going to live and all they're going to get is just what they say. I'm going to have a good time and I'm going to live it up. For this is what life is all about. This is all that life's going to be to you, because this is what life is all about. But the Bible puts it a little plainer. What does a man profit if he gain the whole world and he loses his soul? What will a man give in exchange for his soul? Brother Steve, what are you trying to do today? I'm trying to get you to realize, number one in your life has got to be God. Number one in your life cannot be your job. Number one in your life cannot be your family. Number one in your life cannot be finances. Number one in your life cannot be education. Number one must be God, and God must be number one, and we must not be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. Give Jesus a hand clap. The devil would have you to be ignorant of the promises of God. That's why that one of his devices is he wants to blind you to the truth. Peter put it that some are ignorant to the truth, but they're intentionally ignorant. They know to do good, but they do wrong anyway. And the Bible said of him that is a sin. You look at what happened to Samson. How did Samson get in trouble? He got in trouble because he occupied his time the wrong way. There's some people say, Brother Steve, I know how to occupy my time. I get up in the morning, I gotta have my cup of coffee. I get up in the morning, I gotta be at work. I get to work and the first thing we hear is the jokes on the job. We hear the fussing and the cussing. Hallelujah. And we have not fed our soul with nothing else, and that's the first thing that we eat early in the morning. We'll fill our stomach when we get up. When we get up in the morning, we'll make sure we have a good breakfast. We'll stop at McDonald's on the way to work because we know that if we don't get something to eat and you to eat, that we're going to get weak before lunchtime and we're not going to be able to do a good job. And the same goes with our spiritual walk. You get up in the morning time, if you don't feed your soul something, by noontime you're going to get weak, and by noontime you're going to get in trouble. Oh, Brother Steve, I go to the church every Sunday morning. That's not what God's word says. We must live according to him and live in him every day of the week, and not only on Sunday, but we need to love him 24 hours a day. Jesus is coming and we got to be ready. Give Jesus a hand clap. Oh, the Bible tells us that Samson got in trouble because he occupied in the wrong camp. We're living today in a world that you watch the TV and all you see on all the ads is a sexual revolution. They try to get your mind off of something else instead of your mind of where it should be. We need to be careful this morning that Jesus is coming and that we're not sleeping. The Bible tells us there was 10 versions. I've often looked at the versions as church members. They were 10 church members, and 10 of them were in, all 10 of them was involved in the work of God. But there was 5 of them was just members, but 5 of them, they paid their tithes and done everything that the pastor had asked them to do. They prayed for the church. They invited people to the church. They lived a holy life outside of the church so that people wanted to come and get what they got, because they seen what they got was not what they had. Then all of a sudden the trump of God shall sound, and this is what's going to happen to the church world. There are going to be some that thought they was going to make it in, but they have not prayed. They have not read their word. You say, Brother Steve, you're an old-fashioned preacher. That's okay. I realize that if you're going to make heaven your home, that you got to eat God's word. You got to sleep God's word. You got to live in God's word. You got to occupy till Jesus comes. And you can't occupy in your own time, but you got to occupy in the word of God. If you try to occupy any other place, you're going to get in trouble. We got to be careful that we don't fall to the devices of the devil. devil. The Bible tells us in Proverbs, the 6th chapter, we need to be careful not to fall into the devices of the devil. Well, Brother Steve, I don't know what the devices of the devil with. If you're following with me this morning in Proverbs, the 6th chapter and the 16th verse, I'm going to tell you what the wisest man, Solomon, that wrote the book of Proverbs said. He knew what it was, and he knew what it was to follow the devices of the devil. The Bible tells us in the Old Testament, my people perish for the lack of knowledge. It's time that we find out what the devices of the devil is. You're not going to be overcoming Christian and overcoming child of God if you don't know what the weapons of the devil is. You got to know what it is, and you got to look for them. Paul said we got to be careful lest we fall at the devices of the devil. It's time for us to get the word of God, and it's time for us to know what the devices of the devil are. If we're going to make heaven our home, oh, there's going to be some that's going to go back, but it ain't them that's going back that we're going to look at. We're going to look at them that's going on, that's going to make heaven their home. There's a heaven to gain and a hell to shun, and you got to be ready to meet Jesus. If you're not ready to meet Jesus, you're going to get in trouble. Give Jesus a hand clap. In verse 16 of Proverbs, the 6th chapter, these 6 things does the Lord hate. First of all, if I was the devil, I would make sure that I would get people to do the things that God hated. I would cause them to do the things that God hated. Why? Because it's a war. It's a war between the devil and God. And the way that you win the war is by getting your enemy to do that you want them to do. Hallelujah. And the Bible tells us the 6 things does the Lord hate. Yea, the 7th are an abomination unto him. A proud look. Do you know what's happening to the world today? And I'm going to preach from this for a few moments. Do you know what's happening with the world today? We've got pride in our life. We're putting pride of everything else. Oh, you'll never catch me shouting in church. You'll never catch me weeping in church. You'll never catch me passing a track out on some corner. People know who I am. You'll never catch me going next door and telling somebody about Jesus. You'll never get me inviting somebody to church. Why? There's a word called 5 letters in it. It's called pride. But pride's going to keep you out of the kingdom of God, and pride's going to keep you from the blessings of God. Oh, church, it's time that we lay down this old garment of pride, and it's time that we put on a garment that we're not ashamed of. What did Peter do before Peter got the Holy Ghost? He was ashamed of Jesus. Before Peter got the power, he was ashamed of God. He said, I don't know him. Oh, you've been with him. Your voice betrays him. I've never seen him. He denied him. But do you know what Peter had to do? He had to go back and confess him 3 times. He denied him 3 times. But Jesus on the Sea of Galilee said, Peter, do you love me? Lord, you know I love you. Well, go feed my lambs. Peter, do you love me? Lord, I done told you 1 time. You know I love you. He said, well, go feed my sheep. Oh, Peter, do you love me? Jesus, I done told you 2 times I loved you. It's not what you told me yesterday. It's not what you told me today. And the same goes for me and you. It's not what we God promised God 4 years ago, 5 years ago, 20 years ago. But Peter, what are you doing for me now? Go feed my sheep. I know you said you love me. I look at your works, and your works show me if you love me or not. Give Jesus a hand clap. It's not only with our lips. We all know lip service is cheap. Anybody can talk, but you got to do what God told you to do. These 6 things the Lord hates, and that's what the devil tries to get you to do. Yea, the 7 are abomination unto him. A proud look. He wants you to look behind him, you're high-minded. A proud look. A lying tongue. We know lies will send you to hell fast as anything else will. And the hands that shed of innocent blood. A heart that your devices, wicked emanations. There's so many people, they in their mind, they think. The Bible said if you do it in your mind, you've already committed it in your heart. You might as well make it up in your mind. That's why Paul said, think on these good things. Don't think on the things of the world. What does the devil know? That if he can get wild imaginations in your mind, if he can get wicked imaginations in your mind, then your mind will not be on the words of God. I know this is old-fashioned preaching this morning. I know some of you come in and you hear me to preach about God's love, and I'm going to preach about God's love. Some of you come to hear me to preach about being healed and being blessed, and I'm going to preach about it. But the Bible tells us in Matthew, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And that's where I'm preaching from this morning. We need to make sure that our soul, number one, our heart, number one, is in tune with God. Give Jesus a hand clap. The 18th verse, feet that be swift in running to mischief. There's some people that get in trouble. You hear on every, which every time the phone rings, you know they got a problem. Some families you've seen that stays in trouble. This one's in trouble. That one's in trouble. This one's in trouble. That one's in trouble. And I'm not talking about just the devil fighting you and the devil trying to stop you from doing what God told you to do. But there's some people, they get themselves in so much trouble. Why? Because they run to mischief instead of running to God. They have a little problem and they'll take it in their own hands and say, look, I'll solve this problem. If that man down the streets wants to do me this way, I'll show you what I'll do to that man down the street. If that person on my job wants to do this, I'll show you what I'll do to him. And this is running to mischief. When you have a problem, it's not your problem. You stand still and you turn to God and let God fight your battle. This battle belongs to God. The devil wants you to run to mischief. The devil wants you to take it in your own hands. The devil wants you to work it out, because he knows that if he can get you to work it out, that you're going to mess it up and you're going to turn it upside down. It's time for us to say, God, the devil's there. I know what his device is. I know what he's trying to do. He's trying to get me to get my mind off of God, out of the Word. I'm not going to do it. I'm going to stand to the Word of God. Give Jesus a hand clap. The devil wants you to do it. The devil knows that God hates it. The devil knows that God hates it when you don't look to him and depend in him. God wants you to depend on him. A false witness that speaketh lies, and he that soweth discord among the brethren. The devil loves it when you do it. The devil loves it when you talk about people. The devil loves it whenever you take something that you hear that you really don't know if it's the truth or not. And God hates it. God hates it, and God despises it, and it's one of the weapons that the devil has deceived so many people to talk about other people. Church, if you hear something about somebody else, the Bible says don't tell your brother, but tell it to God. Your brother can't do nothing about it. And do you know how you get in trouble? When you tell somebody else, for that somebody else is going to tell somebody else, and that somebody else is like the dentist told one of my kids. One day, she was sitting in the seat scared to death, scared of the dentist. And the dentist said, honey, what's wrong? Said, oh, are you scared? Said, yeah, I've heard about dentists like you. And the dentist, he looked at her and said, honey, some people can't tell a story unless a story be exaggerated. A story is not worth telling. And church, there's some people who take what you say and add a little to it and say you told it, and you get full responsibility of it, and you are held responsible if you hear something, even if it's bad. If you hear something, even if it's terrible, you tell it to God. God's the one that can help that person. We can't, but he can. Give Jesus a hand clap. The devil hates people when they start praising God. Oh, you say, Brother Steve, what are you trying to preach on this morning? I'm trying to get us to open our eyes to what the devil's trying to do. The devil's trying to get us to get our eyes off of the Word and get our eyes on things in the world. Oh, you say, Brother Steve, how can I do it? Well, the Bible said, come out from among the world and be a clean and a pure and a holy people. Well, Brother Steve, what can I do to you this morning? First of all, the first step that every one of us must do, we must know that
we're born again. And we must know without a shadow of a doubt that if Jesus should come today, there's no sin in our life. Once we know that we're born again, then we need to start praising Him. And we need to pray every day. And from morning to night and from night to morning, we need to continue offer up a sacrifice of praise. We need to get into His Word and read His Word and study His Word. The Bible said we need to study the Word, rightly dividing the Word. Why? So that we may be reproved. Church, there's going to come a time that you're going to have to stand on the Word. And if you don't know the Word, then you're going to be in trouble. If you don't see the devices of the devil, sometimes the devil will cause you to want to stay at home from church. He'll tell you that you don't feel like it. Why does he want you to stay home? He knows if you come, you're going to receive the Word, and the Word's going to build your faith. And when you get your faith built, you're going to receive a miracle. Give Jesus a hand clap. The devil knows that if he can cause you not to pay your tithes, that God has not promised to you, and he has not promised to help you. And he knows that if you don't pay your tithes, then he'll tell you, well, you can catch him up next week. You can catch him up next month. Hallelujah. But you know what the devil's doing? He's using a device against you. And do you know who he's causing you to do it? Not the man down the street, but he's talking you into doing it. If he'll let you talk about putting your tithes off until next week, next month, he knows between now and next week and next month, because you did not pay your tithes, God's not going to bless you. And next week, next month, you're going to be in worse shape than you are this week and this month. And it's going to be piled upon you because you're having to fight it by yourself. Oh, Brother Steve, where are you preaching from this morning? I'm trying to help you to see the devices of the devil. Don't let the devil deceive you. Don't let the devil make fun of you and mock at you. It's time for us to take a stand. Oh, Brother Steve, it's not popular to stand. Oh, but church, it might not be popular to stand. Oh, but when you hear those precious words, well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter into the joys of the Lord, it will be worth it all. It'll be worth it all. Give Jesus a hand clap. There's some people that occupy their time. And I'm not preaching against football games or baseball games. But they'll go to a football game and a baseball game and stay there 3 hours. And won't come to church for an hour. What's wrong with your love and your relationship with God? You'll sit down and you'll say, Brother Steve, I'll watch the movie for 4 hours. When's the last time you prayed for 4 hours? Where's our occupying time? Where's our relationship? Oh, Brother Steve, you're stepping on our toes this morning. Let's stop and think about this thing. If I asked every one of us here this morning, what is the number one thing in your life? The first thing that every one of us would say is sometimes we may slip and say our wife, our children, but then we'll realize that God is still number one in our life, and we'll say God's number one in our life. But who do you work for all the week long? Who do you represent all the week long? What are you doing that will support the most important thing in your life? Oh, Brother Steve, I pay my tithes every Sunday morning. I come to Sunday school and I come to church. I'm at church the total of about 5 hours a week, maybe 6 hours a week. And I fall down on my knees and say, Lord, lay me down to sleep. And Lord, make sure nobody don't break in and scare me tonight. And I go to bed. Oh, but this is not what we need to do. We need to get our relationships right. We need to know it out of all. Brother Steve, you're shaking us up this morning. Church, I'm trying to get you to see the devices of the devil. And the devil can get you to occupy your time with other things. And it's okay for the ball games. It's okay to do these other things. But don't you think the one that we love the most should get the equal amount of time when we give it to the world? If we sit down to a football game for 4 hours, don't you think we need to read God's Word and pray and study God's Word for 4 hours? We need to occupy our time and do those things which God would be proud of us to do. Give Jesus a hand clap. And you don't have to be a prophet or son of a prophet to understand the next verse that I'm starting to say. You know those times in your life that you got real close to God? Stop and think about it. Do you remember those times that you was in a revival and got all fired up and you was praying every morning and reading your Bible? Don't you remember the joy that you had? Don't you remember when you got on your job, those guys over there telling those jokes and doing those things, you didn't even want to have no part with them? Why? Because you had your priorities right. Your priorities were right. Oh, but Brother Steve, how can I do this? There ain't but one way you can do it, and that's to sell out to Jesus all the way. Do you know what the devil hates? The devil despises for a group of people to get in unity and speak the name of Jesus. The devil despises for a mother and a mama and a father to get in unity and call on the name of Jesus. The devil despises for a saint of God to fall on her knees in her prayer closet and to call on the name of Jesus. Why does he do it? He knows that his weapons is not working against this child of God, against this family, or against the church. When we get together and begin to pray in unity, we're going to see things happen. And church, this morning, I thank God that we got to pray in church. I thank God we got praying people. I thank God that we got people that can move the devil. Oh, but church, we need to continue in prayer. Paul said we need to continue it, not only because we got saved, not only because we're 70 years old or 60 years old or 30 years old. You need to pray every day. This is something that you got to do every day. Give Jesus a hand clap. Do you know what the devil don't like? He don't like for the saints of God to start praising God. Why? Because he realizes that his devices is not working. He realizes that whenever you lift your hands and start praising God, and when you open your mouth up and you start speaking the name of Jesus and praising the name of Jesus, that his proud look ain't working. He realizes that pride is not working with you and working in you. Oh, Brother Steve, I don't know about that. I'm afraid of what somebody next to me is going to think. I found out a long time ago, I got one priority in life, and that's to satisfy God, and God only do I want to satisfy. I'm not here trying to be a popularity contest. I'm here to stir up your hearts. I'm here to stir up your souls. I'm here to build a fire under your feet and to let you know that if you're not careful, the devil's going to get you at the post, and he's going to build a fire, and he's going to crucify you, and he's going to tear down. But you ain't got to have the fire of the devil built on you. You can have the fire of the Holy Ghost that will stomp out every weapon of the devil, every device of the devil. And by no means shall any of them harm thee. Why? Because you belong to God. Give Jesus a hand clap. Some of you used to pray an hour every day. Some of you used to read your Bible an hour every day. Stop and think about it. Are you doing as much for God today as you was 5 years ago? There's some people, they say, Brother Steve, what can I do around the church? How can I help around the church? What can I do to further the gospel of Jesus Christ? This is not my gospel. This is not the gospel of Brother Dobbs. Not the gospel of Paxson Revival Center. But every time these doors open up and the lights are turned on, we're presenting and representing Jesus Christ. Every time we get on television, and if you'll listen to our telecast, I'm telling them right up front, one reason I'm here, and to let you know about Jesus. And church, we're representatives of Jesus Christ. This church here is not only known here on the west side of Jacksonville, it's not only known here in the city of Jacksonville, but there's not a city, not a conviction, and not a revival, not a camp meeting that I've ever gone to that somebody did not hear of the name of Paxson Revival Center. Why do you think they've heard of it? Not because of my education, not because of Brother Dobbs's education. It's because of the praying saints that we have in this church that knows how to get a hold of heaven, knows how to shake heaven, and knows how to ask God, and knows how to look for it to happen. Church, when these saints begin to pray, heaven begins to shake and the devil begins to tremble. The devil don't like it when saints of God start praising God. And church, this is where we need to go. We need a Brother Dobbs is preaching on prayer, the power of prayer. We need to get into our prayer closets. We need to shut the closet, take the telephone off the hook, turn the television off, and get on our knees. And let's ring the bells of heaven. Let's dial Jesus up and tell Jesus what we want. And when we ask it, I know you folks, you begin to move the devil, and the devil has to back up. Give Jesus a hand clap. When we pray, I know things happen. Have people tell me, Brother Steve, aren't you concerned about this? Well, when you get concerned, that's one of the devices of the devil. He'll put fear in your heart. Then when fear comes in, unbelief will come in. When unbelief will come in, doubt will come in. That's why I'm convinced, turn it over to Jesus and praise him for it. Turn it over to God and give him praise for it. What are you doing? You're saying, okay, God, it's not my problem, it's your problem. You bought and paid for me with the blood of your son, Jesus Christ. I'm not my own. I'm bought with a price. I belong to you. This is not my battle. This is your battle. You fight it. You take care of me. I'm going to follow you. I'm going to be your witness. I'm going to proclaim your name. I'm going to lift up your name. The devil tried to put sickness on some of your body, but you just ain't going to take it. You just give it back to the devil and say, by whose stripes I am healed. The devil tries the device of calling you back in and say, you got to go back in for another test. We found something else. It don't look bad. Do the same thing you done the first time. Throw it back to the devil and go to God and say, God, I thank you that you healed me the first time. By whom stripes we are healed. When the devil tries again, do the same thing. All for this, like the song says, he'll do it again. He'll do it again. He'll do it again. You just stand fast and don't fall to the weapons of the devil, the devices of the devil. If you don't get nothing else out of this morning's service, I want you to realize while Brother Ralph is coming to the organ that we are the victors. We are the winners. We are the one that's going to come out on top. Give Jesus a hand clap. The devil would have you to be ignorant of the devices. The devil sometimes even says in some church, in your communities, you're suffering for the glory of God. God don't get any glory out of you suffering. But I tell you, when God does get glory, when the devil throws it to you, you throw it back. I tell you, when God does get the glory, when you say, by your stripes I'm healed, I'm standing on your word, by your stripes I'm healed. I tell you, when you do get it, when that son that comes in with drugs and alcohol, and mama, you know you done put him under the blood. You know that you done claimed that soul for Jesus. You see him coming in under that condition, and you know the device of the devil. You say, I claim salvation for the soul. I claim salvation for my husband's soul. He may still be running the roads. You see him out in the streets. Oh, you walk by him, raise your hand, and I thank God that he's going to be saved. Don't fall by the devices of the devil. If you're not careful, the devil will destroy you. It's time that we hold on to the promise of God. Heaven and earth may pass away, but this is one thing you can hold on to. Church, hold on to God. God's going to hold on to you. Give Jesus a hand clap. The devil would like for you to sit down and quit, but ain't no time to sit down and quit. And I know this morning I preached different. God has been dealing with me in the past few days that the church needs to pray more than we've ever prayed before. Not only our church, but the community, the church community, we need to pray more. Why? Because I believe that just before Jesus comes, the devil's going to make a swing harder than he's ever made before. And if you don't have your mind made up, and your feet is not planted in concrete, and your mind is not already tuned in and say, I'm going to make heaven my home. If you don't have the mind of Christ, and if you don't have the heart of Job that says God gives and God takes, through it all, I'm going to still bless his name. If you don't have that kind of heart, the devil's going to do something that's going to turn you around. But it's time for us to get our eyes off the problem and get our eyes on the problem solvers. For I know when we pray, something happens. Why? Because we have a God that answers prayer. We have a Jesus that is on the throne, and he is standing there with his arms wide open, and he is saying, come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. What is he wanting you to do is just look to him. David said, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to Jesus. When I don't know what to do, lead me to Jesus. When the problems is more than I could bear, lead me to Jesus. And church, this morning, that's where I want to lead you to. I want to lead you to Jesus Christ. For there is no other name but the name of Jesus. I want everybody to stand. stand this morning, I want you to lift your hands up and say, God, open my eyes and let me see. Open my ears and let me hear what God has to say to the church. Lord, this morning, as every hand is lifted, every heart is open up, every ear is open up, every spiritual eye is open up to the things of God. Lord, this morning, let us realize that if we're going to make heaven our home, that we cannot fall by the devices of the devil, but God, that you would give us power, that we can tread, that we can walk out. And now, God, we know the devil fears the name of Jesus. And so this morning, in the name of Jesus, shall the saints speak. And in the name of Jesus this morning, shall the saints ask for their miracle. And Father, according to your word, we stand on your word this morning, that Lord, from the front of this auditorium to the back of this auditorium, Lord, this morning, let us be like David, Lord. When David said, search me, O Lord. Search me on the inside. Search me on the outside. Lord, I know that I used to be close, but I'm not close anymore. Lord, this morning, draw back. Lord, to that person that don't know you as their personal Savior, don't let them leave this morning until they have their name in the Lamb's Book of Life. For the problems they have now are only small problems if they don't turn to you this morning, God. Lord, and call on you and get help from you, the problem's going to get bigger. Now, God, this morning, for them that are in the church, let them remember their first love. Remember the way they used to praise you. Remember the way they used to run the aisles. Remember the way they used to testify of you. Remember the way they used to pray. Remember the things they used to do for your glory and your honor. And Father, this morning, let them get back to the place they used to be. And God will give you the praise for all that you're going to do in this service this morning. Strengthen your church. Encourage your church this day. For God, we're going to come out on top. We're going to come out victorious. The devil has no hold on us. The devil has no power on us. For greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And God, I thank you for the saints of God that we have in this church. They know how to pray. Lord, hear their prayer. In Jesus' name we pray this morning. I love you, Jesus. Lift your hands up and say, I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. You're not telling you love him. You've been saying it with your lips. Say it with your heart. I love you, Jesus. His life for me. If you want God to bless you this morning, and you want God to turn around some things in your life this morning, some of you say, Brother Steve, I've carried this burden. I just long to get under the Spirit of God that I had once. I want everybody from the front of the church to the back of the church, I want you to just come down. I want you to put your hands up and tell Jesus you love him. If you want God to bless you this morning, if you want to draw closer to God, if you want the things of God in your life, and you want the blessings of God in your life, I want you to come. I want you to come. You need God this morning, church. Some of you think you can make it by yourself. You cannot make it by yourself. Some of you are having problems in your finances, problems on your job, problems in your life. Stop and think. When's the last time that you fell on your knees and called on God? Stop and think. Are you living the life that you used to live for Jesus? Oh, the closer we get, the closer we need to be. I said, the closer we get, the closer we need to be. Oh, let's lift our hands up. Tell God that we love him. Everything. Is he your all in all? I said, is Jesus your everything? Is my everything. Both great and small. He gave his life for me. Made everything new. Oh, I love you, Jesus. Strengthen your people this morning. Encourage your people this morning. Lord, we thank you for your word. None other but Jesus Christ will do. I want everybody to find a place to kneel and pray and just tell Jesus you love him. If you're one of the ones that I was preaching about this morning, that you're not at the place you used to be, you know who you are. You know that you used to dance in the Spirit. You used to weep and you used to cry. You used to pray every day. And oh, how you had peace in your heart and peace in your home. And we wonder what's happening. We need to get back to our first love. We need to get back to our first love. Make everything new. Oh, he will. I said he will. Christ is my everything. None other. Nothing else can do what Jesus can do for you. Christ is my everything. He is my all. Lord, this day, Jesus. Lord, this day, Jesus. This day, Father, let your power be stirred up within us. Let your promise be stirred up within us, Jesus. This day we strengthen. Strengthen this body. Strengthen this body, a daughter of Abraham. In Jesus' name. Oh, church, go ahead. You got to get right. Christ is my everything. Oh, hallelujah. Yes, Jesus. Lord, this day, God. Lord, you said that you would make a way. Thank you, Jesus. Open up the windows of heaven this day, Jesus. In Jesus' name, bless the Lord. Keep her healed. Keep your angels, Jesus. This day, God. This day, Lord. This day, God. Lord, we're at the place we need you. Lord, we know that you can help. Lord, we're your children. We're your children. Lord, we picked up the pieces and we're looking to you, Jesus. Lord, bless them this day, God. They're your children, God. Lord, bless my brother. Bless my brother, Jesus. Open the windows of heaven. Open the windows of heaven this day. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Lord, she's praying. Her prayer's my prayer. Lord, let it happen. Let it happen in Jesus' name. Oh, yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, from the front to the back, Jesus. Lord, we want to do your will. Lord, we want to be where we used to be. Lord, we want to be where we used to be. Lord, we want to live where we used to live. We want to feel what we used to feel. Lord, we want to be able to speak the words of faith that we have spoke. Lord, you'd answer prayer when we did. Lord, we ask you to do it, Jesus. We ask you to do it. Lord, touch my brother Robert. Keep strengthening his body. None other but Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Keep her healed. Every joint, every muscle, in Jesus' name. Oh, your children, God. Your children, Lord. Your children, Jesus. Lord, keep her healed. My everything. I love you, Jesus. Both great and small. Do you love him this morning? Tell him you love him. Tell him you love him. Do you know how you get close to him by telling him you love him? Lord, I'll do what you want me to do. I'll speak what you want me to speak. Lord, I'll do it, Jesus. Christ, you're my everything. Lord, you're my everything. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus. Yes, Lord. This day, Jesus. This day, Lord. My everything, Jesus. My everything, Jesus. My all in all. Oh, hallelujah. Yes, Lord, you said not more than we could bear. Not more than we could bear. The word we stand on. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You're my Father. Father, we thank you. Hey, use life. Church, we need to be stirred in our spirit. We need to say, God, I want it the way I used to have it. I want it the way I used to have it. Lord, I'm not satisfied the way that I am now. Lord, I want to be back where I used to be. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Christ is my everything. Lord, touch this mother, a daughter of Abraham. Lord, you've been good to her. Lord, keep her healed. Keep strengthening her body. Is my everything. Both great. He's our everything this morning, church. I said he is our everything this morning, church. God should be number one in your life. God should be number one in your life. Lord, we want you number one in our life. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, let it happen. Lord, I touched him, and Lord, you said there's a prayer that his heart's cried for. Let it happen. Let him be filled with the power in Jesus' name. Jesus, I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. Do you love him? Do you love him? Do you love him?
Thanks for watching this awesome video clip. If this sermon has been a blessing to you, help us out as we put more of these videos online. It takes thousands of dollars to put these videos online. Please go to PaxsonRevivalCenter.com and donate to help us spread the gospel to everyone in the world. Go to PaxsonRevivalCenter.com and click on the donate button. God will bless you.
Church, I can feel God starting to do something right now if you'll open your